offers you the possibility of enjoying nature at close quarters. Competition is another possibility which canoeing offers you, where you can measure your effort against others, either in kayaks or in canoes. In still water competitions, canoes compete in C1, C2, and C4. The shortest distances are 500 meters and 1,000 meters. The distance is covered in straight lines and in lanes. Resistance races are 5,000 meters, 10,000 meters, or even more. And various buoys are negotiated along the route. In speed or resistance races, the paddling technique is crucial in order to obtain good results. For some coaches, this is a real challenge. With our friend's help, we hope to make things easier. Let's go step by step. The canoe is logically the basic piece. Made of wood, fiberglass, or carbon fiber. The dimensions are limited by the regulations. The shape, the length, the width, and the weight. The wooden grille adapts itself perfectly to the hull of the canoe. This offers a flat surface where the canoeist can adjust the knee pad and footrest to his liking. The knee pad is where the canoeist rests his knee. The dimensions vary, but these can serve as a reference. The gap for the knee is anatomical and slightly oblique and should be reasonably comfortable. The knee pad should be fixed to the floorboard by some kind of brace so that it can transmit the propulsive force sent by the knee to the canoe. The footrest ensures a resting place for the back foot. Adding a strap will keep the foot in place against the footrest. The front foot rests on the floorboard. Some canoeists use non-skid tape on the floorboard to prevent slipping. Here, we also have a small foot pump. In team boats, the equipment is similar to that described. T2, the knee pads rest partially against the hull, and the height of the gap is slightly greater. In C4, the height is even greater, so that the canoeist is better situated. The paddle is the canoeist's contact with the water. It consists of three parts. The T-handle should be comfortable and permit good control of the paddle. The shaft is a round tube. The pulling hand is placed on the lower part, and just below we find the wear strip. The blade is the part which contacts the water. It represents slightly more than a third of the overall length. The face is flat, except for a small ridge which acts as a division. But the backside is rounded. The bottom edge should be perfectly finished to ensure a clean entry into the water. The overall profile of the blade must allow for an easy extraction from the water. On a practical level, the length, the blade surface and the positioning of hands is crucial for a canoeist to make the best of his physical and technical possibilities. As an example, we may say that the length of the paddle should be 8 to 12 centimeters shorter than the height of the canoeist. The positioning of the hands also varies. The system used by Narciso can be very useful. This can be checked later in the water. Although the differences are slight, not all canoeists hold the paddle in the same way or use the same proportion in length. The difference is dictated by the canoeist's physical build and his own paddling technique. In order to make the blade effective for a longer period in the water, there are some which have a small angle. On embarking, the canoeist should place the knee pad 15 to 20 centimeters behind the center of the canoe. So that when the boat is still, the bow is slightly higher than the stern. Then when the canoe is in movement and the canoeist transfers his weight forwards, he can partly avoid the sinking of the bow. On the other hand, the knee is placed 2 to 5 centimeters to the side of the center line on the paddling side. The rear footrest is angled about 20 degrees to the offside. These resting points, together with the front foot, form a triangle which represent the canoeist's resting point in the canoe. When the boat is still, the angle of the front leg exceeds 110 degrees. From behind, we can see that the back is vertical, or leaning slightly towards the water. In team boats, the position is similar to C1. The greatest difference we can see is the proximity of the knee to the side of the canoe. In general terms, the canoeist must adopt a position which is reasonably comfortable and which permits him to keep his balance and control the canoe, but above all, it must be compatible with his paddling technique. The canoe advances through the water by means of impulses or strokes transmitted by the canoeist in a cyclic, continuous motion. The length, force, and duration of each stroke is determined by the speed we require for a given situation or competition. Thus, we can see that the shorter the distance of the competition, the greater the number of strokes per minute. This frequency increases in C2 compared to C1. There are also variations during the course of a race. In resistance races, the rhythm is slower, although there can be abrupt changes during the race, depending on the tactics used. Apart from the rate of strokes, the canoeist looks for two basic things in each stroke: a good loading point, so as then to be able to propel himself forwards efficiently. All this without losing his balance. If a canoeist copies a particular style, he should allow for some variations, so as not to hamper his own personal qualities. We shall look at the different parts of a stroke: the entry, the catch phase, the exit, and the air transfer. Entry is the moment the paddle enters the water. To do this, the canoeist moves his whole body forwards towards the water, so that the stroke gains amplitude and inertia. The hips and legs move, accompanying the movement. The torso flexes forwards and forms a continuous line with the thigh of the kneeling leg, and it rotates approximately 30 degrees. The pulling arm is horizontal, and the steering arm is over the head. The paddle then has an angle of approximately 45 degrees. In this movement forwards and towards the water, the canoeist has to keep his hips orientated to stern. Looking from behind, if we imagine a line joining the canoeist's side and his thigh, this should tend to be straight. The correct positioning of the different parts of the body at this stage will determine the success of the following stages. On entry, the canoeist uses the weight of his body. The torso bends towards the water. The paddle is vertical, and the hips should maintain their position. The arms descend slightly. The main difficulty in this phase, either during the air transfer or catch phase, is in maintaining good control of the hips when the canoeist transfers his weight out of the canoe. The heel fixture is very important at this stage. The most common errors on entry are various: lack of torso rotation, pushing downwards, excessive hip movement, or wrong paddle angles, etc. Thank you. The catch phase describes the movement of the paddle in the water. It is the driving force, and it is the most complex part. Taking the canoe as a reference, the paddle follows a curve from the moment of entry. In each moment of the catch phase, the paddle has a different angle to the water and a different efficiency. The most efficient position is when the paddle is 90 degrees to the water. Rest of the positions give different results. Yet, while they also help to drive the canoe forwards, they are at the same time responsible for part of the movements which cause the bow to pitch and heave. The distribution of force during the catch phase is also important. Some canoeists have a strong increase in force during the first third of the catch phase, thanks to a strong attack on entry. Then the force diminishes progressively. Other canoeists distribute the force more evenly. The increase is less, but it is maintained for a longer period. In the first case, the paddle sinks earlier and its course is more circular. In the second case, the course is longer and less curved. But in both cases, the stroke is effective for these canoeists, who are both of a similar competitive level. Looking from behind, the paddle works perpendicular to the water, following a line which is almost parallel with the canoe. The canoeist's performance during the catch phase is clean and without loss of inertia. From the moment of entry, the shoulders rotate, the hips go back slightly, and they also rotate towards the offside. The legs transmit the impulse by pushing backwards. The torso rises in a continuous movement. The arms maintain the position of the paddle, but they have no initiative during the catch phase. The steering arm descends as the torso rises. Just before the exit, the hips begin to rotate towards the paddling side, and the body moves forward. It's a difficult movement, but it helps the exit and the entry, and it partly eliminates the negative effects caused by the forward movement of the body during the air transfer. During the resistance stroke, the amplitude, the force, and speed are never the same as in a speed stroke. Overall, in this part, once the canoeist has placed the paddle in the water, he impulses himself by rising and moving backwards, at the same time transmitting the impulse through his resting knee and his forward foot. In the last part of the phase, the canoeist advances, still with the paddle in the water, positioning himself in time for the next stroke. The errors in this phase, besides those which arise from incorrect entry or position, are mainly a loss of inertia as the stroke slows down. And bad working angles in the water. Excessive hip movement, sideways or backwards. A lack of balance of the canoe or the canoeist. When the pulling hand overtakes the line of the forward knee, the rear angle of the paddle increases. Then the paddle should exit. The extraction of the paddle from the water is quick, clean, and doesn't cause the canoeist to lose his balance. The paddle comes out sideways, moving up and away from the canoe, thanks to the movement of the arms and the rising of the torso. The top arm moves away, and the pulling arm rises slightly. With the speed stroke, we must avoid a high exit, which would make the canoeist lose balance and time. The exit should be easy and quick, otherwise something is wrong. The canoe should not suffer from unnecessary movements. The air transfer links the exit with the entry. Paddle follows a straight path, ascending if the entry is high, and parallel to the water if the entry is lower. During this phase, the canoeist must adopt a position for a good entry. The legs advance, the torso bends and rotates, the hips maintain continuity between the torso and the pushing thigh. The top arm rises away and the pulling arm moves in a straight line until it is horizontal with the water. The blade travels at an angle and turns at the last moment to adopt the correct position of entry. The most common errors in exit and air transfer are those which make the whole movement slow down or lose inertia, besides errors in the previous stages. Hips placed too far behind, balance problems, etc. An analysis can help us to understand what happens in each stage of a stroke, but we mustn't forget that each stage is part of a complete movement, and each stage will be influenced by the previous one, which will then influence the following one. The paddling technique represents a basic pattern which the coach will adapt and use to get the most out of each of his canoeists. This way, each of them will develop his own personal style. We think it is wrong to impose a rigid following of one particular style for everybody. Here we can see that among different canoeists of a similar level, there are appreciable differences in paddling style, dictated by their individual characteristics. Thank you. Although the steering is part of the stroke, we think it deserves to be studied apart. Owing to the hydrodynamic characteristics of the canoe, its lack of a rudder, and the asymmetrical paddling, the canoe tends to steer in different degrees towards the offside. A situation which can be made worse by winds, strong currents, or waves. But it is the lateral wind which most influences the direction of the canoe. Laterally, the canoe has a greater surface exposed to the wind at the rear. If the canoeist is the center of the canoe's turning point, the wind will push the rear of the canoe as there is a great area exposed, causing it to turn. When the canoe is in movement, this means it will turn towards the side of the wind. If the wind comes from the paddling side, the canoe will turn in that direction. The canoe will move in a straight line with a minimum of effort. The maneuvering technique is used by the canoeist in order to move in a certain direction or to correct his course. Offside steering is the most commonly used due to the canoe's characteristics. It is performed by the steering arm and helped by the pulling arm. When the blade is about to exit, the blade is turned up to 45 degrees. And on exit, it meets the resistance of the water, which produces an effect in the opposite direction, moving the bow of the canoe. In this way, the canoe moves in a straight line or towards the paddling side. To make the steering effective, it must fit into the stroke perfectly. And besides steering the canoe, it should pass unnoticed. It shouldn't slow down the stroke or cause loss of balance. It should be performed only by the necessary amount and at the right moment. Evidently, in a race, a lot of factors influence the strength of the wind, its direction, the speed of the canoe, buoys. Then we must know how much we should steer in each circumstance. The canoeist's sensitivity, which increases through training and experience, will tell him how much and when. In adverse conditions, when offside steering slows down the speed of the canoe, we can use onside steering. Onside steering is based on the same principle. On entering the water, the steering hand turns the handle slightly so that it enters the water moving towards the canoe 20 to 45 degrees and separated 15 to 20 centimeters from the side. In order to make this steering effective, we must use the weight of the body on entry. In this way, the inertia created by the falling of the torso produces the desired effect with little effort and hardly any loss in the effectiveness of the stroke.